Praise the Lord. Galatians, the 6th chapter, and we're going to begin the 11th verse. Galatians 6, verse 11. I was thinking of this old song, and I'm going to take for a title this morning a excerpt from this old hymn, this old song. And it goes like this: the world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before me. No turning back, no turning back. That's the 4th verse. The first one is, I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Though none go with me, I still will follow. No turning back, no turning back. My cross I'll carry till I see Jesus. My cross I will carry till I see Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The world behind me, the cross before me. No turning back, no turning back. How many of you know that song, that old hymn? Amen. I'm going to take for a title this morning those words, the world behind me, the cross before me. Praise the Lord. Galatians chapter 6, verse 11. Father, we come to you, Lord, this morning, and I ask that you would give me the words to say, that, Father, you would anoint me, that your Holy Spirit would come and give me the words to preach. You are the teacher, the preacher, and we are in need of you this morning to go forth and deliver your message. And I ask you, Father, that you would use me as a vessel to be able to accomplish what you would have to be done. Open up our ears and our hearts to hear and to believe. And Lord, we pray that the enemy of our souls, be bound and cast far away, that he would not be able to deceive, disrupt in any way, shape, or form. And we give Jesus Christ the praise and the glory. Yes. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. Amen. Galatians chapter 6, verse 11. Paul gives us a detail here for the book of Galatians. He tells us that he wrote this letter with his own hand. There was many times in the scripture that Paul would use a dictator in the sense of that he would dictate what he wanted, and then someone would pen it, and then towards the end of the letter or the epistle, Paul would write a final benediction. He would, with his own hand, sign it, sort of speak. But we see here in the book of Galatians that Paul has written the entire book with his own hand. He says, you see how large a letter I've written unto you with my own hand. As many as desire to make a fair show in the flesh, they constrain you to be circumcised, only lest they should suffer persecution for the cross of Christ. The cross of Christ symbolizes nothing of yourself, but all of Jesus. Amen? It symbolizes nothing that you could do, but it was all what Jesus did. And you see, any of ourselves, anything that we do with our own hands, that is where men like to glory. And Paul understood very well that men like to glory in the flesh. Men like to be able to pat themselves on the back, show their diploma, show why they deserve what they have done, what they did themselves to accomplish something. But the cross of Christ does something that is against all of the fleshly nature. It says you couldn't do nothing good enough, you couldn't bring nothing great enough. You had to rely 100% on what someone else did for you. And that someone else is Christ Jesus and what he did at the cross. He says they desire to make a show of this. They desire to be able to say, well, because I was circumcised on the 8th day, this is what the Jews desired to say, because I did this, That is why I am saved today. Because I was able to bring something to the table. I was able to be saved. And Paul says, no, the only way that this is going to work, the only way salvation will come to us is when we glory, when we give our faith, when we put all of our rest on what Christ did. He says, only lest they should suffer persecution for the cross of Christ. For neither they themselves who are circumcised keep the law, but desire to have you circumcised that they may glory in your flesh. Now I want us to understand this morning when we're getting into what I want to share. This says circumcision, and it's talking about the law of Moses. But we would see that before the law of Moses was given, God gave the covenant of circumcision to Abraham. So it's not an act of the law that it was just an elite thing. God gave a covenant of circumcision long before the law came. He gave it as a sign to Abraham of the covenant. But Jesus Christ came to fulfill that covenant. Yes. So everything that we have must be found in the cross of Christ. So you could almost place anything you want in place of the word circumcision here. Because anything that you and I bring religiously to the table for our salvation, for our forgiveness, anything that we bring and we set it down as an offering to God that because I've brought this, now I can be forgiven, you could almost put right there in that place. And when we do that, it removes persecution from us. You better believe it does. Because it now places our faith into something other than what Christ has done. He says in verse 14, but God forbid that I should glory, save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. And I want to bring out those words as we look at the title today, the world behind me, the cross before me. He says, I will glory only in the cross of Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. I want to take you to Romans, the 6th chapter. One easy way to remember what we're talking about is Galatians 6 and Romans 6. It's both found in the 6th chapter. And we're talking about being dead in Christ today. We're talking about the world and our old man being crucified and a new man living for Christ Jesus. What Paul is giving to us in Romans and in Galatians, he is instilling within us how to live victoriously for Jesus Christ. I think so often there are so many believers who live defeated and they place their faith in something other than Christ. How many times are you discouraged and you're struggling and a new book comes out and it offers the allurement of a new way of you're struggling and so I now have a new way to be able to give you deliverance. I now offer you a new thing and we go buy that book. We go seek that way. It says in Romans chapter 6, it says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? We are dead to sin. Did we understand that today? When he said in Galatians chapter 6 that I have been crucified, Galatians 2:20, I'm crucified with Christ. Galatians 6 tells us then that if we are crucified with Christ, the world is dead to me and I am dead to the world. The world no longer has dominion over you. Sin should not reign in the believer's life. So when the believer is looking to be able to sin and looking to be able to offer God at the same time something that he brings to the table, God won't accept it. It's the same sacrifice that Cain would bring. That I'm bringing what I want to give to God. But God required the blood. Yeah. Amen? God required a specific sacrifice and nothing else will please him. And so that is the sacrifice of Jesus. It says, verse 3, know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death. So when the believer has been born again and we come and we are water baptized, as that believer goes under the water, it is a type of being immersed into Christ, buried under the water with Christ in the grave. And as that believer then emerges back up out of the water, it is a type of what the believer has done by faith in our spirit as a new man was born again in Christ Jesus. As Christ was crucified, so am I crucified. As Christ was buried, so was I buried. And as Christ was risen again, so have I been risen again. So if I am dead, what hold does the world have on me? What hold does sin have on you if you're already dead? Amen? So he says, therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. When somebody professes to be in Christ, but they do not have the fruit of a new life in Christ Jesus, I must tell you, Jesus is not a silent partner. The Holy Ghost, when he comes into the life of a believer, there's fruit of that believer being born again. A new life having taken place. And I'm afraid so often today people come, and whether they kneel at the altar and they say a prayer, or whether they are immersed into water and they're say that they're and that they're now saved, if they turn around and the life they now live has not been a changed life, then they are not dead in Christ Jesus. The old man must be crucified.
Yes.
He is dead and buried. And that person must be crucified with Christ by faith. You must reckon yourself dead in Christ Jesus. Amen? He says in verse 5, for if we have been planted. Now remember, Jesus said, I know I'm saying a lot here, but Jesus said that unless a seed die, it could not bring forth the harvest. And he was speaking of himself, that he must die in order to bring forth the harvest in me. That just as he was the seed, it must be dead, and then it brings forth that new life. So he says, and this is the combination that we have, because you are dead with him. And if you don't believe that, then that's why we struggle with sin. That's why sin then seems to have dominion over us, and we can't shake it loose, because we must reckon in our heart, reckon in our mind, reckon in our spirit, that I am dead in Christ Jesus. What hold does the world have on me? And if the world and all of its pleasures and all of its things are tugging at my soul and tugging at my heart, then I must reckon that I am not, my faith is not where it must be. Because as Paul would say, if we place our faith in any other thing than Christ and him crucified, if the world is not crucified to us and we are not crucified unto the world, then there is a hiccup in our walk with God. And I think so often believers today are trying to enjoin two marriages. And I've said this before, and really what I'm covering a broad surface of a lot of doctrine this morning. But Romans 7, Paul begins to tell us about marriage. Now, he's not all of a sudden talking about marriage counseling. He is giving us the idea, the same thing here, that if we are dead in Christ, then that old relationship is cut off. So Paul gives the idea that if a woman is married to a man, and she divorces that man and marries another man while her first husband still lives, Paul says, doesn't the law teach that she is an adulteress? So what Paul, he's not all of a sudden talking about marriage counseling in the midst of this teaching. He's giving us the likeness that death ends relationships. So once someone dies, that relationship is over. There is no longer a communion between dead people. Amen? So once I was crucified with Christ, my old man is now dead. And I can no longer have a relationship with that old life because it's now dead. But if I now try to combine two relationships together, it is as if a woman is trying to have two husbands at once. And Paul is saying it ain't going to work. That isn't how God has orchestrated it, and there will be a problem in your walk. So there must be a death to the first relationship, the old man, in order for that second marriage, which is a type of our new life in Christ Jesus, to flourish. So death must come to my old man so that I might be raised a new man in Christ. And we follow in the teaching that he's saying here. The world behind me, I'm dead to the world. The old life that I lived, that life of partying, that life of drugs, the life of lust, of whoremongering, the life of covetousness and lying and cheating, of wheeling and dealing to get my way, that's the old life. And now it's dead to me. It has been crucified with Christ. And I reckon myself dead to that lifestyle. And now I, by faith, live for a new life in Christ. He says in verse 6, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed. Amen. That sin nature within us that rises up and it wants what it wants and it won't let go until it gets what it wants. You ever felt that spirit? I don't think too many of us have it. If you've lived very long at all, you felt the sin nature rise up within you where you just had to have it. And you can even take two children, two little babies, and you give them one rattle, and you'll see the sin nature rise up within them. It doesn't take long. It doesn't take long at all before you begin to see the desire to my will, what I want. Amen? What I'm number one. It's all about me. It's one rattle and I'm going to get it. Even that little child thinks that way. You don't have to do much to teach your children to do wrong. They will learn it on their own. It just comes natural for us to make the wrong choice. But what you have to do is teach your child to do right. That's where the Word of God comes to play. And so that means that we are born with a sin nature. We are born in the wrong way. And it must be crucified with Christ by faith. And we must now walk in a new life in Christ Jesus. The world behind me. Now it's the cross of Christ that I'm living for. It is what He has done in my faith, holding securely to His blood. It was His body that was crucified. He paid my price that I might be forgiven. You see, we are all born as slaves to sin. You had an owner. You were chained, and your owner was Satan. He had legal rights to us. Amen? Are we following what I'm saying this morning? He had legal rights to you. That's why you will go to hell, and I will go to hell. Because Satan had his legal rights over us. But Jesus came to break that chain, to break those chains of bondage, that you can now change lords.
Yes.
And where your lord was once Satan, and it was because of bondage to sin, now by your faith in Christ Jesus, that old relationship has been crucified, the world has been dead to you, and now by faith you're walking a new life, trusting only in Christ and what He did. Not trusting in that you were circumcised, not trusting in that you did something that purchased your salvation, but it is throwing yourself at the mercy of the cross of Christ, that He did it all for me. And I'm going to cling to that old rugged cross, and it will one day, He will give me a crown.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. He says here, from henceforth we will not serve sin. Verse 7, for he that is dead is freed from sin. Now, if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with Him. So if we have been crucified with Christ, just as He was dead and buried, so as He was raised to life again, so do I have the hope of being raised to life again. There is a new life that I have in Christ. I'm not the same man I used to be. And I pray that you're not the same person you used to be. And when we can't really tell, then there is a problem with where our faith is trusting in. We must turn from the world and look exclusively to Christ. He says, verse 8, now if we be dead with Christ, we believe we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, he dies no more. Death has no more dominion over him. It's a finished work. Jesus will not have to ever shed blood again. He has paid the price. It is done. He says, for in that he died unto sin once, but in that he lives unto God. And then I want to end with this. Likewise, reckon ye also yourself to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. You've got to reckon yourself dead in Christ. You've got to reckon yourself to be crucified with him, but alive as he was risen again. That is the walk of victory that we have with Christ Jesus. Your faith, trusting in what Christ has done. As that sin nature would rise up within us. And I don't know entirely why, when we're saved, that sin nature doesn't just immediately go away. But if you don't keep trusting in Christ, that sin nature will rise back up again. And you know it too. I mean, we're living a life we don't see that sin nature will try to cheat and to lie and do what it used to once do again. There's believers who were saved, truly born again. But as they continued to live, they began to put their faith in what they then did and the life that they were now trying to live for Christ through their own means and effort. And they began to be in worse sin than they ever did before they knew the Lord. That sin nature rose back up again. That's very possible to happen when we take our faith off of what Christ did for us. You need to reckon that you're dead in Christ. The world is dead to you. And you are dead to it. You ever heard those people who get into a fight with a person and they say, you're dead to me. You're dead to me. They're saying, I no longer know you. I want nothing to do with you. Our relationship is over. Because death ends relationships. So they say, you're dead to me. Well, see, that's what we have to do to our old life. We're dead to it. The world is dead to us. I won't go back. And isn't that what that old song says? No turning back. No turning back. The world's behind me. The cross of Christ is before me. I won't turn back. I won't turn back. The Bible would give us the reminder of remembering Lot's wife. She turned back to the world. And she began to be, and she turned instantly into a pillar of salt. No turning back. No turning back. Verse 12, let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in the lust thereof. And then Paul begins to talk about us yielding our body, yielding ourselves to Christ. Just as you yield yourself to sin, you submit yourself to its way, you must reckon yourself now dead to that. And now by faith you yield yourself to Christ and what he did. You submit yourself to him and you trust fully in what Christ has done. As I, no doubt, there's so much more that I could share here, but I hope to encourage you this morning. If you're struggling with something, which I probably will go out on a limb and guarantee you that you are, because every one of us in a life of constant struggle against the world, the flesh, and the devil. Yep. Is constantly coming against us. The world doesn't just go away. Our flesh is always at enmity with the Spirit. And everything we do, our flesh is trying to rise up against the leading of the Spirit of God. That's why Paul said that in Romans 8, there's no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. And when that's quoted, we end it there so many times. But he goes on and he gives this, finishes the verse by saying, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. it would be nice, I guess, if we could just have no condemnation in Christ and that was it. But that no condemnation comes to us when the flesh is crucified. As long as your flesh is in control, there will be condemnation. But when we are walking in the Spirit of God, when the dominion of sin has been broken by the blood of Jesus, and we reckon ourselves dead to it, then we begin to walk in the newness of life that Christ desires us to walk in. God doesn't want the believer to walk in defeat. He wants us to walk in victory because that's what Christ paid for at the cross. So keep your faith in what he did. Reckon yourself dead to the world, but alive unto Christ. Reckon yourself dead to sin, but alive in Jesus Christ. That the flesh be put under, and that the Spirit of God rise up within you. And that's where we allow the Holy Spirit to lead us. That's where the believer lives. Their faith solely resting in what Christ did. And now they let the Holy Spirit guide them. And that filthy condemnation that wants to then come upon us, when you're walking in the Spirit, it has no place because it's under the blood. Amen. Just like Cammie was singing, put it under the blood. Yeah. Amen. That's what we have to do, praise the Lord. Yes. If you bow your heart with me this morning. Paul would say all of that, and really, in order to grasp what Paul is saying, we just jumped right into the middle of his letter. You have to read all of Romans and understand what Paul is stating here. But he is stating that we are justified by faith in Christ Jesus. Your faith must rest solely in what Christ has done. You must reckon yourself dead to sin. The old man is dead and buried. Don't let it rise up again. Because you must live a new life in Christ Jesus. Just as Jesus rose from the dead, so do we raise a new person in Christ Jesus. So don't let sin have dominion over your life. Don't allow the devil to speak lies to you and get your faith off of something else. When somebody comes out with a new book that tells you this is the new way of victory, or this is the new way to explain how to live for God and how to defeat sin, let me tell you today, there's one book that was written, and it is an old book. It's the old paths, and it's called the Word of Almighty God. That's the book we need to be learning and reading of. That's the book that explains to us how to walk before the Lord. As we look at all of the newfangled things, and even modern psychology has infiltrated the church world so much that we think of just talking about our problems. And no doubt, when we talk about things, it does get things off of our chest. It can make us feel better. But let me tell you today, if you confess your sins to a man who is struggling with the same sin nature that you are, it will do you no good. You must go to Christ. Confess your sins to him and allow the one who bore your sins upon the cross to forgive you and wash your sins away. That's the confession that there must be. Otherwise, there's no forgiveness. Father, I come to you, Lord, this morning. Father, I pray that you would mold our hearts so that this world would truly be dead to us. Our old sin nature, we would reckon ourselves dead to it, that it would no longer hold dominion over us. Lord, that condemnation that tries to sneak up upon us, Lord, I know that if we walk in the flesh, of course there's going to be condemnation. Because your word is giving us the way and we're not walking in the right way. And so the condemnation of sin begins to weigh us and get us down. But Lord, in the name of Jesus, we by faith reckon ourselves dead to sin. We reckon ourselves dead to that sin nature, to the world, to the flesh, to the workings and the powers of darkness, to the devil. And we reckon ourselves alive into Christ that we might walk a new life in Jesus. Lord, I pray that we would yield our bodies as instruments, yield our vessels as instruments of righteousness and not to the works of darkness. Just as in the past we submitted to the emotions and to the to the workings of the body of sin. So now we recognize that we are dead in Christ. The world is dead to us, and we are dead to the world. And now we reckon our body, our instruments, as members of righteousness unto Christ, that your Spirit might begin to work through us. And Father, we know that the working of the Holy Spirit is true, and we don't snuff out the Spirit of grace, because we know how strong the Spirit of grace is. We need the grace of God in our life, and grace comes through faith. Yes. And I thank you, Lord. May you give to us the power that comes through the Holy Spirit, yes, through faith in what Christ has did at the cross. Jesus paid it all. And by his stripes I am healed, I am delivered, I'm set free. So I reckon myself dead to the world, and the world's dead to me, and I'm alive now in Christ Jesus. May that be our heart's desire, and may that be where our faith is placed. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Does anybody want prayer this morning? I know that in the church world today, it seems like people take sin, and that word sin, and they either make so light of it that it's nothing, or else they treat it as a bad word and they don't want to even talk about it. And if you even mention about sin, it's like, oh. But the truth is, every day we wake up, we're in a battle against sin. Every day we wake up, there is something. In fact, John would tell us that there's the lust of the flesh, there's the lust of the eyes, and there's the pride of life. These three things are not of God, but they're of the devil. You could take every sin and source it back to one of those three things. The lust of the eyes, what we see. Covetousness, the desire to want. The lust of the flesh, the desire to what this natural body wants. And the flesh, the desire of it. And the pride of life. Pride is a disgusting, horrible thing that exerts itself up above everybody else. And God would tell us that no flesh would glory in his presence. And those three things, so often every day we wake up, those three things rise up against us in one way or another. So to say that sin is a bad word, or to make light of it, is foolishness on either way. Because you and I know sin is real. And the desire of our flesh to want it is disgusting. Amen? But Jesus came to defeat it. Any born-again believer, and it's been said, and I believe it to be true because I've been there, the most miserable person alive is the born-again believer struggling with sin. When you don't feel any emotion, when you don't feel any struggle against sin, and they're not crucified with Christ, you're not saved. And that's why people can party and drink and they feel nothing about it. But when the believer is struggling with sin, and there is that constant crying for deliverance, they are a miserable human being. Because they hate sin, because Christ is in them, the Holy Ghost is at work with them, and the Holy Spirit don't like sin. He came to convict the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. And so when the Holy Spirit's at work in your life, and you're feeling that power of sin at work in you, and you're hating it, you're struggling with it, well, that's a good thing, because it means you're a born-again believer. If you don't feel nothing at all, you're just dead, spiritually dead, and that's why you don't feel nothing. But when we feel that struggle, that's the Holy Spirit drawing us out, wanting us to let go. And when you were at that point, that's when we must reckon ourselves dead with Christ. Your faith can't be placed in that you were good yesterday, or you said no to it yesterday, or anything that we do. We place our faith in water baptism. We place our faith in that we are speaking with other tongues. We place our faith in something that we did, that we said a prayer. We confessed our sin to the Pope or the priest. We put our faith in all sorts of foolish things in this world, and none of it can save.
And that's why we struggle with sin. I'll probably make somebody mad here. Hopefully I don't. That's why the Catholic priests, so many of them are pedophiles. Because they think that they can confess their sin to another man and they can be forgiven. And yet, deep rooted inside of the heart of these so-called holy men, there is the most grotesque, demonic powers of darkness at work in their life, because the sin nature is alive within them and they can't defeat it. And they're trying their very best to confess it, to do the prayer beads, to kneel down to the idols of stone and confess their sin. I saw a picture of the Pope, and you've seen it too. He's kissing the feet of Jesus on the cross. That I don't care if it's Jesus on the cross. That's an idol. Yeah. It is Jesus Christ, dead, buried, and risen again.
Hallelujah.
If the cross around your neck has Jesus still on it, it's called a crucifix, and it's a lie. Because Jesus is alive. That cross is an open cross. That grave is an empty tomb. Jesus is alive and he's risen. And if your faith is still keeping him buried in that or dead on that cross, then you're at that point where you're just dead. But Jesus died and he rose again. This story would be a bad story if there wasn't the resurrection afterwards. Amen? Jesus paid the price. He was dead and buried, but because that his blood was perfect and his sacrifice was perfect, the tomb is empty. He rose again. And now I can reckon myself alive with him. If it wasn't for that part of the story, it would just be I'm dead, which I'm dead in my sins anyway. But now because Christ has risen again, I am alive in him. Amen. As we look to all of these things that the world tries to bring, and we try to overcome sin by all of these other means, we struggle because we're not looking to the one and only way that sin was defeated. So I want to pray for you. And so back to my first question, if there's anyone here this morning, whether you're struggling with sin or whether you just feel the burden of condemnation, because condemnation will come when we're walking in the flesh. When flesh is living, we must be crucified with Christ. Amen. I want to pray with you. And I'll be honest with you. I know I'm asking you to, if you want prayer, but every one of us, this applies to you. There's not a soul living that the sin nature doesn't affect, because you're born with it.
Yes.
Amen. So, if you want prayer, I want to pray with you. Amen. Come on up here, brother. Come on up here. If you want prayer. And if